Welcome students. Today we are going to discuss about the conservation of this biodiversity. So to conserve the wildlife and to manage the biodiversity, we need to follow three steps. That is, the controlled or the limited exploitation of the species, establishment of protected areas, that is your national parks, wildlife sanctuaries, biosphere reserves. Besides that, we can also go for the geological parks, and we can provide protection to this wildlife through legal and legislative efforts. So we can have some laws, rules or orders to protect the wildlife. So there are two basic strategies of biodiversity conservation. Either we can protect the wildlife in their own location, or we can bring them out of their habitat, and in our supervision we can take care of them. That is called as ex situ conservation. So first we are going to go for the in situ conservation. So the strategies are going to include the in situ and the ex situ conservation. Now we are going to discuss about the in situ conservation. So we may get this in situ conservation as a long question, maybe 5 marks question, or definition of any one of it we may get. So what is in situ conservation? It is the conservation of biotic resources in their natural habitats. That means we are going to allow the biotic resources, that is the wildlife, that is the wild plants and animals, are allowed to stay in their own habitat or in their natural habitat, and there only we are going to conserve them. How we are going to conserve them? By the protection of the total ecosystem. So we are going to take care of their habitat and the wildlife in their natural areas. So this total ecosystems can be called as the protected areas, or we can define this protected areas as the biogeographical areas of land or sea, where biodiversity along with the natural and cultural resources is conserved through the legal or other effective measures. So we are going to maintain, so biogeographical areas either of land or sea, where we are going to maintain the biodiversity along with the natural and cultural resources. How we are going to do this? Through the legal method, or by through this other effective measures we are going to follow, and we are going to maintain this biodiversity. So basically this protected areas comprises of national parks, wildlife sanctuaries, your biosphere reserves and the sacred groves. So basically in our syllabus we have this protected areas definitions have been included. Besides that, we have the definitions and the examples are been included. So we may also get a difference between the national park and the wildlife sanctuary. So here, if you are going to define this national park, it is an area strictly reserved for the betterment of wildlife. So here, the national parks are considered as the special reserves where we are going to take care of this wildlife and we are going to try for the betterment. Here, forestry, grazing or cultivation are not permitted. So in this national park areas, the wildlife have been taken good care of. And the forestry means collection of this forest materials or this kind of activities, grazing of animals or cultivations are not allowed. So more or less you can say human interference is not allowed in these areas. Next comes, here no private ownership right is allowed. So private ownership means sometimes some forest parts have been taken as given by the government on lease, and from them from those areas whatever products have been produced, that can be taken by the person who had taken for the lease. So here no private ownership right has been allowed in case of national park. So the areas which are coming under this national park, no one can take any part of it personally, or private ownership has not been allowed to them, to anyone, or on lease we can cannot give any part of this protected areas to anyone. No habitat manipulation activity is permissible. That means we cannot manipulate, we cannot change any means part of this forest through this manipulation activities. So we cannot change the structure of the habitat by any means. In India there are around 112 national parks. examples we have, I have taken this many or more or been there, whatever you are comfortable with, you can go for those examples. Zim Corbett National Park, Kajiranga National Park, Kanha National Park, Gir National Park and the Sundarbans etc. are the national parks. So on the contrary, we are going to go for the second type, which is called as the wildlife sanctuaries. These are also protected areas where protection is given to the fauna. Here also we are going to give extra care to the wildlife only, that is animals only. So certain operations like harvesting of timbers and collection of minor forest products are permitted as long as they are not interfering with the well-being of the animals. So here a little relaxation has been given. So certain operations have been allowed, or certain activities, human activities have been allowed, including harvesting of timber. So timber can be taken from the areas and the forest products, minor forest products can be collected, but this is allowed under certain terms and conditions. So these are permitted as long as they are not going to interfere in the well-being of these animals. As long as the collection of this forest products and this harvesting of this timbers are not going to affect the animals, this will be allowed. Private ownership rights are allowed. So the parts of the this forest have been taken on lease, and that is called as your private ownership, and whatever products will be whatever forest products will be there, they will be taken by this special contractors. So in India, around 515 sanctuaries are present. Example is Annamalai Sanctuary, Dachigam Sanctuary, Nagarjuna Sagar Sanctuary, Manas Wildlife Sanctuary, Periyar Sanctuary and Chilika Bird Sanctuary. So here also you can change the names if you wish, because we do have more than this number of examples. So now we are going to go for the third type of protected area, which is called as biosphere reserves. So these are specialized protected areas. Basically these biosphere reserves are larger than that of this national parks and the wildlife sanctuaries area wise. So it represents the natural biomes and certain unique biological communities. So basically the biomes which are going to have special biological communities, they have been taken, and they have been taken care of under the MAB, that is your Man and Biosphere project. So here it is a multi-purpose protected area of habitat wherein man is an integral part of the system. So here human beings are considered as a part of this biosphere reserves, or it is going to be the human beings are all are considered as a integral part of this whole system. Then comes the wildlife of the included forest area is protected in the conserve. So here also we are going to take care of this wildlife which has been coming under this protected areas. Human activities are allowed under regulated conditions. So under regulated framework, regulated conditions, the human activities have been allowed. Due to absence of human interference, diversity and integrity of naturally growing plants and animals is maintained. Because human activities have been allowed to certain extent only, and to certain up to certain zones only, so the diversity and the integrity of this naturally growing plants and animals can be maintained. So because human beings are not interfering to each and every zone of this particular forest areas, so the integrity and the diversity can be maintained. These are used for ecological and environmental research, education and training. So basically for research works, the permission has been given to this scientist for this research works, for education purposes and for training programs, the human beings can be allowed to enter into this biosphere reserves. It is designed for multiple land use. So multiple land use means we are going to have three particular zones of this biosphere reserve. See, I'm going to take a example of this. So very large forest areas have been taken into consideration in this case. The central part is called as the core zone. So this is the centrally located part, which is called as the core zone. And here it is the also considered as the minimally disturbed area of the biosphere. So here minimum interference of this human beings has been found. That means human beings are not allowed to enter into this zone. And here no human activities are also been permitted. So this is the most protected area where no human interference has been allowed. Hence it is minimally disturbed area of this biosphere reserve. Next comes Next to this, we do have one more area. This is this area. The second area is called as the buffer zone. It is the zone which is present outside the core zone. And here we do have limited human activities pertaining to educational and research purposes are been allowed. That means in this area also human activities are not, these are been restricted. Human beings activities are restricted. But only the research works can be done here. That is for educational purposes and research purposes only, the human beings or the scientists can be allowed to these areas with special permissions. Next comes the last zone, that is the outermost zone, which is called as the transition zone. So in this transition zone, we are going to have, this is the outermost peripheral zone, and this is exposed to an active cooperation between the forest management and the public. So here a good cooperation has been found between the forest management and the public. That means here the cultivation, manipulation, restoration and everything can be allowed in the peripheral zone, which is otherwise called as the transitional zone. So basically it can have this manipulation zone where this tribal settlements and all the cultivated lands have been present. And the restoration zone is also been present here. That means the degraded areas of this forest are also worked on. And they have been restored to the natural conditions. Next comes, so we do have 18 biosphere reserves in India. Examples are Nilgiri, Nanda Devi, Pachmari, Simlipal, your Gulf of Mannar, and Nokrek, Panna. These are the bioreserves. So etc. You can go for the names which you are comfortable with. Next comes sacred groves. These are the sacred forest tracts which are held in high esteem around the places of worship. That means some areas have been there where we are going to worship. There is certain temples or religious places have been there. And around those worshipable areas, some forest or forest tracts have been present. So because of the Lord or because of the religious beliefs, those areas, those forests are not been allowed to have any human activities. So here, these are also the protected areas, but instead of the action of government, the local people take care of these areas and they protect these areas. So this sacred areas are basically undisturbed areas which are protected by tribal people due to some religious causes. So due to some certain taboos or certain beliefs, the local people take care of these areas and they keep it undisturbed. This includes most undisturbed forest free from any human interventions. In these groves, not a single branch is allowed to cut from the trees because of the beliefs. The tribals or these local people never allow any destruction or they never allow any injury to any branch of the plant also. Example is Khasi and Gentia hills of Meghalaya, Aravali hills of Rajasthan, Sarguja, Chanda and Bastar areas of MP, Western Ghat of Karnataka and Maharashtra, etc. So you may get this as a whole long question, or you may get any one of these protected areas at the short comments or 2 marks question. So take care.